Welcome. I'm Ulrike Stern, director and CEO of the Fritz Ascher Society for Persecuted, Ostracized, and Banned Art based in New York. We research, discuss, publish, and exhibit artists whose life and work were affected by the German Nazi regime between 1933 and 1945. With this work, we commemorate their lives and achievements. Please support this and future virtual programs with a donation. You can find the link in the chat function. Today, we will discuss the photographer Fred Stein, and as our first speaker, I'm honored to introduce his son. Peter Stein has been the director of photography on over 50 feature films, TV movies, and documentaries, covering the last 35 years, and was invited to join the prestigious American Society of Cinematographers in 1999. He grew up learning photography from his father. After deciding on a career in film, he became a camera operator on the feature film Between the Lines, directed by Joan Micklin Silver. He has lensed major studio and independent releases, including drama, comedy, suspense, horror, and various cult films, and has been nominated for 2 Emmy Awards. Peter has taught at SUNY Purchase and the School of Visual Arts, has lectured on cinematography at the New School, Hofstra, Fairleigh Dickinson, CCNY, Marist, and UMass, and was a professor in the graduate film program at New York University for 13 years, where he also served as head of production. He manages the photo archive of his father, Fred Stein, and produced and directed the film Out of Exile, the photography of Fred Stein. Welcome, Peter.
Thank you very much, Rachel. We all are a product of our history and our story, and also our personalities. And certainly an artist will show his or her history and personality in their art. And that's one of the reasons I produced this film, Out of Exile, with my wife, Dawn Freer, who was the co-director and the writer and editor of the film. Let me tell you a little about my father, my father's story. He was a real intellectual. He knew so much about history and literature and theology, philosophy, science. He was a true intellectual, and he used to regale us with stories of the people that he met at the dinner table. He would always, when I was a child, he was always going out taking pictures around New York City. And he, very often I would go out with him, and he taught me how to see life sort of through a frame. And we spent time in the darkroom together, and he showed me how to talk to me about composition and about lighting, and how to print pictures and develop film. And so I owe my career and my, well, my life to him. And so I've been very active in promoting his work. And so that's one of the main reasons why we made this movie. Let me tell you some more about him. He was born in 1909 in Dresden, Germany. His father was the rabbi for the community, for the conservative Jewish community. This is his father, Leopold Stein. My mother, on the other hand, is from an aristocratic Jewish family that had lived in Dresden for hundreds of years, and I mean, well over 200 years. And this is her grandmother's house, And her house was very close by. But they were quite wealthy. Here's a picture of the inside of the house. Now, this house is still standing in Dresden, and it's called the Villa Salzburg, my mother's maiden name. Of course, when the Soviets took over Dresden's in the East Zone, the former East Zone, when the Soviets took over, they plastered over all the woodwork and anything that was considered too opulent. The house has now been renovated. Of course, they could never bring it back to its original form, but it's quite beautiful. This house was the first house taken by the Nazis from Jews, and it was made their headquarters. And then during the, once they built their own headquarters, they gave this house to the Red Cross, which is why it's still standing, because during the firebombing of Dresden, they had volunteers on the roof with buckets of water putting out the fires. So, and this is my my mother's father. He was a famous doctor, an ear, nose, and throat doctor. He was a doctor to the King of Saxony, as well as many of the nobles of the court, and also to the opera singers. Dresden had and still has a very famous opera house, the Semper Opera. And he also had a private pro bono practice for indigent people in Dresden. My father was a brilliant student. He skipped 2 years in the gymnasium, which was unheard of in those days and probably still today. And here he is with his, I believe it's his college class. He's the on the lower left with his legs over another student. And then he went to law school. He wanted to be a lawyer to help the poor people in Dresden. And it's interesting, he graduated first in his class from Leipzig University. And that was in 1933. Well, 1933 was also the year that Hitler was elected to become the Chancellor of Germany. And in those days, in order to practice law, which Fred wanted to do, you had to serve 2 years in the state prosecutor's office as an apprentice. I don't know if you still have to do that in Germany, but that was a government job. And one of the first laws that Hitler passed was that Jews couldn't work for the government. So Fred couldn't be an apprentice, and so he could never practice law. But he got a job in a, one of his friend's fathers owned a factory, and he got a job there. And he got married to my mother, Lilo. And here they are in Dresden, walking down the street. One of the interesting stories that they told me is when they got married, this was under the Hitler regime, in the city hall, they had to give Heil Hitler salutes, which freaked them out. So that was those times. And one day, his friend, whose father employed Fred, told him that he needed to leave Germany right away because the Gestapo were asking questions about him. And the week before, they had arrested a young woman and she was never heard from again. So Fred had become a socialist when he was 16 years old and was very active in giving lectures and handing out literature. And of course, at that time, he was giving talks to, against Hitler and fascism. So he was in a very dangerous situation, and they decided to go to France, where a friend of theirs, Herbert, actually their best friend, had left Germany, and he was urging them to come because it's too dangerous for them. Well, France in those days was an amazing place for refugees. It was open to refugees, and there were people from all over Europe who were coming to Paris, especially. certainly political people and writers and artists and musicians and philosophers. It was a really quite a unique place. But the French were very concerned about these foreigners taking jobs from French people, from French citizens. So it was hard to earn a living, and you had to prove that you had money in order to stay there. Fred said that when they were in Germany, they were proper, but now that they were in France, they were bohemians. And they had a little bit of money because they had just gotten married and they got some wedding money. So they were able to afford an apartment. And so they had many people coming over, many of the poor refugees, especially in their same political circles, who came for lunch and dinner, and they had parties and so on. So it was quite a different life from what they had had in Dresden. But Fritz still needed a profession. Lilo got a job working in a socialist toy factory, which is very interesting. And she was cooking. She would cook lunch for the workers. She really didn't know how to cook. Because she had servants growing up, but she faked her way through it. And friends had suggested to Fred that he become a photographer, because in France, if you were a refugee and you were a writer or an artist or a musician or a photographer, and you could work freelance. And so that's how you could earn money. And one of Fred's hobbies was photography. Here he is with the first model Leica camera. And they had given each other, Fred and Lilo had given each other a Leica camera as a joint wedding present. And so he was able to start photography with his Leica. In fact, he said, "The Leica taught me photography." Leica was small. It was, which was unusual because the cameras before that were quite large, many of them wooden cameras on tripods, and you couldn't work very quickly. Well, with the small Leica, you could move around quickly and you could work quickly. You could advance the film. It was movie film on a roll. And so all you had to do was wind it up, take a picture, and you could move around very quickly. Fred considered himself an artist, and Dresden is one of the museum capitals of Europe. There are many, many museums in Dresden. And when Fred was a young man, a teenager, his mother had gotten him a subscription to all the museums in Dresden. It was an organization that controlled all the museums. And so Fred loved art. And he took courses in college and high school on art. And so here are some, this is the Swinger Gallery Museum, very famous museum in Dresden. How did he make money as a photographer? Well, the first way they made money was they made, my mother was his assistant, when she wasn't working. And he took pictures, tourist pictures, and then they made postcards and they would sell them on the street to tourists. You could always tell who was a tourist. And so this is one of their postcards. And then another way that they made money was they made postcards of well-known left-wing speakers, and during rallies and demonstrations, they would sell postcards in the crowds. So that's how they made their money. Then in 1939, France declared war on Germany. Germany had invaded Poland. And what the French did was they, sort of similar to what happened in the United States with the Japanese, They took anyone who was who they considered was a threat to them, and put them in internment camps. And who was a threat? They were anyone with a German passport, for instance. Well, it could have been a Nazi, it could have been a Jew, it could have been a communist, it could have been a socialist, it could have been someone who was non-political, but anyone with a German passport or anyone else who they considered, because there were so many others, refugees, anyone they considered was potentially dangerous to them was put into an internment camp. But they didn't put my mother into an internment camp because my sister, my older sister, at the time was a year and a half. And my mother was the mother of a French citizen. My sister was born there, so she was a citizen. So they wouldn't put the mother of a French citizen into an internment camp, but they put the father of a French citizen into an internment camp. So that was in 1939. And the German army made a quick defeat of France, really very quick. And France gave up, and it was divided into two countries, Free France or Vichy France, and occupied France, where Paris was. And as the German troops were advancing on my father's internment camp, of course, they were gonna liberate the camp, but the Nazis in the camp would be liberated and the Jews would be sent to Auschwitz. So right before they got there, my father and a whole group of people were freed, and Fred decided to make his way to Toulouse, where he knew someone who would be able to put him up, he felt. And so he walked. It was over 500 kilometers to Toulouse. Meanwhile, my mother had no idea if he was still alive. Well, eventually, and it's a great story, and if you haven't seen the film, you should look at the film, which, by the way, is on the website, the Fritz Ascher website. You should see it. It'll be there for another few weeks. So he made his way to Toulouse. He got in touch with her by sending her many postcards, and one finally got through, telling her in their code where she should come. And she did, and then he went to Marseilles, which was on the coast, and he was trying to get passage to the United States, which is also a very interesting story, how he was able to do that. And this is Varian Fry, who many consider to be the American Schindler. He saved over 2,000 refugees from Marseilles. And his mission was to save artists and other intellectuals and writers, musicians. I mean, people like, he saved people like Hannah Arendt and Chagall and Max Ernst and Jack Lipschitz and just many, many people, wonderful. He's an amazing person, and his story really needs to be known by people around the world. And the reason that he was able to save Fred and Lilo and Mimi, my sister, was because Fred was on a list to be arrested for his political activities in Paris. So he was still very active in political groups. This is Varian Fry again. I'd like to talk now about Fred's photography. So you will notice in many of his pictures, even group pictures of people on the streets, that there's always, or not always, but very, very often, there's someone relating to the camera and relating to the photographer. Fred was non-threatening. He was a humanist. He loved people, and people just relaxed with him. Plus, it was a little camera, and he could move quickly and unobtrusively. And in those days, tiny little cameras were not that, were quite unusual. So people didn't react the way they would today if you went up to interesting looking people on the street, it might be dangerous. Now, this is in New York. Here's New York again. And you could see, I mean, he took pictures and people just did not feel threatened at all. This is in Little Italy. These Italian women, this was in 1943 in Little Italy. I mean, they're tough and maybe they're wondering, but they're not threatened or threatening him. He certainly considered himself an artist and was certainly aware of photographers of the day. This is similar to some of Bresci's photographs, the famous photographer who did Paris After Dark or Paris by Night. So Fred certainly considered himself an artist. In fact, I remember going to a lecture with him at the New York Public Library, which was, is photography art? So photography was not considered art by everyone or by most people when Fred started his photography. It's another artistic, and you see his compositions and his understanding of light. Here's a good composition. And he did not organize these shots at all. If you see the lighting in this shot, he waited for a long time to get the light just right. There's the cars, and this is the Place de la Concorde, the silhouette, something that really interested him. Here's a good composition. He was part of a movement in photography at the time, which was called New Vision, or part of the modernist movement, which photographed details and different compositions, different angles. So he was aware of the artistic movements of the day. Here, this was an example at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, a Bill Brandt exhibition of nudes, which is certainly part of the New Vision movement, pieces of bodies and so on. And then there's a piece of an arm, which is Fred's New Vision photograph of a New Vision exhibition. And it's also an example of his humor. He took many pictures that are really quite funny. Again, the New Vision photography had low and high angles, which was unusual in the day. Here's just a piece of a scene. Another high angle. Let me talk a little about his portraits. This is his most famous portrait of Albert Einstein, an iconic picture. He had an appointment for 10 minutes and he ended up spending 2 hours with Einstein because Einstein wouldn't let him leave. He loved talking to Fred, and Fred's idea of photographing people was to engage them in conversation, not to set them in place. There's a photographer, famous photographer Karsh in Canada, who would place people and show them how to sit and move and so on and light them and then take their picture. Fred had them being natural and normal, and he would talk to them and engage them and then take a picture when he felt it was just right. He had three types of portraits. One was photographing people at conferences and meetings and parties and so on. So these are examples of that. And another was in their homes or studios, where he really could speak to them in depth and take their picture. Norman Mailer was a client of Fred's. Mailer would call him occasionally to have his picture taken. Otto Dix in his studio. Chagall was also one of his clients when Chagall lived in New York. Herman Hesse. And this is Frank Lloyd Wright just outside his studio. And the last way he would photograph people is in his own studio. So Fred had two studios on 57th Street at different times, but that was very rare. And he mainly photographed people like Richard Wright in his own studio, which we had at home. So he photographed over 1,200 personalities in his studio in his career. And it's really important for the historical record that these photographs be preserved and be known for historians as well as the general public. And also it's important in the history of photography that his work is not forgotten.
Thank you so much, Peter. Today we're lucky to have even a second speaker, and I'm honored to now introduce Ulrike Kuschel, who has curated the Fred Stein exhibition at Deutsches Historisches Museum in Berlin, Germany in 2021. Ulrike Kuschel studied fine arts at the Berlin University of the Arts, Hochschule der Künste in Berlin, and has realized numerous artistic projects in Germany and abroad. In 2010, she was a fellow at the Villa Massimo in Rome. At the same time, she worked for a picture agency for many years and taught photography and the history of photography at various universities. From 2017 to 2020, she was a member of the jury of the Kunstfonds Foundation for the publication and education program. Since 2019, she has been working on various projects at the German Historical Museum, Deutsches Historisches Museum in Berlin. In 2019-2020, she assisted in the exhibition Hannah Arendt and the 20th Century. And in 2021, she curated the exhibition Report from Exile, Photographs by Fred Stein. She's currently working on a digital history project. Welcome, Ulrike.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction. I am very pleased. I am very pleased to be invited to talk at the Fritz Ascher Society today. As Rachel said, I curated the exhibition Report from Exile, Photographs by Fritz Stein in 2020. Which was presented at the PI exhibition building of the German History Museum, Deutsches Historisches Museum in Berlin. It was the first exhibition of Fritz Stein's photographs with a focus on the historical and political dimension of his work against the backdrop of exile. In my presentation, I will address the central theme of the exhibition, how Stein became a portraitist of German-speaking immigration. In 2020, Stein's portraits of Hannah Arendt were on display in the exhibition Hannah Arendt in the 20th Century. His iconic portraits of Arendt, taken between 1944 and 1966, continue to shape our image of her today. Other portraits of literary and political exiles, for example of Alfred de Vigne or Willy Brandt, became part of the collective visual memory in Germany too. How did it happen that the self-taught photographer Fritz Stein photographed all these personalities? In my talk, I would like to outline Stein's political commitment and the different networks that played a decisive role in the formation of his portrait collection. The 1,000 square meters exhibition traced Stein's professional career, showing some 160 mostly original photographic prints. It was divided into two main areas. On the first floor, his early work from Paris was exhibited, street scenes, political and social documentary photographs, and portraits. On the second floor, photographs and publications from Stein's career in the USA were on display, including documents from his last unfinished book project. As Peter has mentioned, Fritz Stein was politically active already in his youth and became a member of the Socialist Workers' Party of Germany. In October 1933, he fled to France as he feared arrest. This certificate of membership in the Jewish community from October 1st stated, Stein leaves Dresden to make a living abroad. We wish the generally popular and highly talented young lawyer all the best for the future. Until the start of the Second World War, France was the main European destination for refugees from Germany. Overall, around 100,000 German-speaking émigrés stayed in France for some time. Paris became the hub of immigration for German speakers. Fritz Stein and his wife Lilo opened their studio Stein in 1934 because it had become impossible for Stein to continue his training as a lawyer. Stein's photographs soon appeared in French magazines and newspapers, in the German Exile press, and in Jewish newspapers too. The heart of the exhibition was this room titled Paris, Center of German-Speaking Immigration, with about 40 portraits of literary and political exiles. It comprised portraits of people from various ideological backgrounds. Among them, famous writers such as Bertolt Brecht, Leon Feuchtwanger, Heinrich Mann, and Anna Segers, thus giving an idea of the diversity and multifaceted nature of exile. There were portraits of members of the Association of German Writers in Exile, mainly communists, and photos of people who were engaged in the Spanish Civil War, like the socialist Willy Brandt, who reported as a correspondent for Norwegian newspapers from Barcelona, or the communist Willy Bredel, later a high-ranking cultural functionary in the GDR. We presented also these two charming photographs of Gerda Taro, who was a lodger with the Steins for a while. She died in an accident in the Spanish Civil War. The idea of the diversity and multifaceted nature of exile was deepened in the exhibition by publications and documents in display cases, which provided insight into the activities of those portrayed. Here two books with a pacifist background, a book from 1937 by the politician Helmut von Gerlach, one of the first book covers with a portrait by Fritz Stein, and a publication by the journalist and military expert Bertolt Jakob, whom Stein also had photographed. Stein was 25 years old when he began working as a photographer in Paris. He had many interests and was very sociable. From the very beginning, he used public events such as lectures, concerts, and rallies to photograph well-known personalities, often unnoticed. One example is his photograph of French Prime Minister Léon Blum, taken at a meeting in Paris in 1936. Another example is this almost iconic shot of Boris Pasternak, surrounded by Ilya Ehrenburg, Gustav Regler, and André Malraux, which Stein captured at the first International Writers Congress in Defense of Culture in June 1935, where some 250 writers gathered under threat from Nazism and fascism. Actually, this photo we also used as the cover of the catalog for the exhibition. Today, we can no longer establish whether Stein had a commission or came under his own steam to photograph the event. This is a contact print from the Fritz Stein archive with some photos that we chose for the exhibition. With his second-hand Leica 1, Fritz Stein managed to take vivid snapshots of famous authors on the fringes of the Congress, for example, of Henri Barbusse, Mark Thiel with Fred, or Leon Feuchtwanger and Bertolt Brecht in conversation. Some of his photographs from the International Writers' Congress developed into real long sellers. To the right, a striking portrait of Klaus Mann, taken in 1935 in a hotel in Paris. In 1935, Fritz Stein joined the Association of German Journalists in Exile, where he made contact with other prominent fellow exiles. The Association of German Journalists was refounded in emigration. Its chairman was Georg Bernhard, shown here in a portrait from 1936. Bernhard was one of the most respected business journalists of the Weimar Republic and editor-in-chief of the Pariser Tageblatt, the only German daily newspaper in exile which was published until 1940. The Journalists Association helped its members, who were often stateless and penniless, by donating clothing or obtaining identity papers. For example, Georg Bernhard helped Stein to become a member of the International Journalist Organization, since he needed a confirmation of his status as a journalist for the renewal of his identity card. The Journalists Association became the starting point of a network that Stein carefully cultivated, as some correspondents show. Among the members were also the well-known art critic Paul Westheim and the journalist Milly Zirker, who in Germany had belonged to the inner circle to the Weltbühne, published by Karl von Ossietzky. Stein joined the executive board after the previous board had broken up following the so-called Pariser Tageblatt affair. Likewise, the journalist Wolf Frank, who was also a board member of the Association of German Writers in Exile. Stein photographed him here in the typical pose of a male intellectual at the famous Café du Dôme. Stein apparently had good contacts with some members of the Association of German Writers in Exile, which is, for example, suggested by this photograph of the poet and novelist Rudolf Leonhard in a garret. Leonhard was one of the founders of the Writers' Association in Exile. As a literary scholar, Wolfgang Emmerich wrote, he played a decisive role in determining the activities of the political literary exiles in France. Alfred Kantorowicz, who together with Leonhard was in charge of the organizational work of the Writers' Association, also lived in a tiny attic room that he shared with his partner. Rather intimate portraits like these provide rare insight into the living conditions of the immigrants. In February 1936, a committee to prepare a German exile popular front was founded in Paris under the chairmanship of Heinrich Mann. After the founding conference, Stein photographed Heinrich Mann and playwright and poet Ernst Toller, as was written on the back of the photographs. Toller and Mann appear tense and exhausted. In 1965, Stein commented in a letter to the Austrian-American journalist Julius Epstein, quote, cooperation with communists in German organizations, such as the Journalists Association and the Association of German Writers in Exile, had become a farce. This verdict can also be applied to the German Exile Popular Front, which was also increasingly dominated by the communists. Paris, however, was not only the center of German-speaking immigration, but also the capital of the avant-garde and a center of developments in modern photography. In 1935, Stein exhibited with Man Ray, Ilse Bing, and others in the exhibition La Publicité pour la Photographie at the Galerie de la Pléiade. Jacques Chiffrin, who ran the gallery, organized solo exhibitions, for example, of Boels, Florence Henri, and Joseph Breitenbach. He thus helped the international photographic avant-garde to advance. Stein's photographs were shown there in three group exhibitions. Stein was stimulated by this inspiring environment. To me, it seems quite obvious that his photo Hole and Fence was inspired by André Cartet's photo Circus Budapest from 1920. In 1939, Stein's first phase of photographic production came to an abrupt end. With the beginning of the Second World War, he was interned as a so-called enemy alien. In 1941, he managed to escape to the USA with his family. Laconically, he commented on his new beginning in New York, quote, "Had now lost all my belongings again, got a Rolleiflex as a present so that I could take photographs again." In this self-portrait, he photographed himself self-confidently with the new medium format camera. As documents in the Fritz Stein archive reveal, he worked for a while for Blackstar, a photo agency founded by German emigres, as well as for PIX. PIX acted as an intermediary between emigre photographers and the American magazine and newspaper market. Stein had numerous press and book publications in the years to come. Nevertheless, the family suffered economic hardships. Quote, "The years of immigration were so difficult that I had to accept everything in order to be able to even exist." Stein sought to make contact with the photographer scene in New York and joined the Photo League immediately after his arrival in 1941. The League included some of the most notable photographers of the 20th century, for example, Baroness Abbott, Louis Hine, Lisette Model, Luigi. Photo League members were committed to social critical photography. Under the title Reporter Groups, they completed projects that documented everyday life in different neighborhoods. A similar approach of social documentary characterizes some photo series that Stein took in Paris, for example, of street vendors in the Les Halles neighborhood. In his book, Fifth Avenue, Stein modified the concept of reporter groups. His photographs led along Fifth Avenue from Washington Square Park through wealthy Midtown Manhattan to Harlem, reflecting, albeit in a moderate form, the different social milieus. In 1947, the Photo League was blacklisted as a communist organization. Stein, however, had resigned earlier, in 1945, after learning of the Photo League's ties to communist networks. He was questioned about this in the United States District Court in connection with his naturalization. The photographer Angela Calomiris, who had been an FBI agent infiltrated into the Photo League, confirmed his testimony. As can be seen in this portrait of Calomiris, Stein now also used photographic lights or flash. In New York, Fritz Stein met some people from the emigre networks in Paris again, including former members of the Association of German Journalists in Exile, such as the writer Ivan Heilbutt and Georg Bernhard, whom he photographed in his study in 1941. He helped Stein again with a letter of recommendation. Bernhard died 1944 in New York. I found this portrait of Berthold Viertel printed in the newspaper Aufbau. It illustrated congratulations from Thomas Mann on the Austrian playwright and director's birthday. Stein's photos, which, quote, "were mostly taken for Aufbau or agreed upon beforehand," as he wrote to Manfred George, were often printed in the German Jewish exile newspaper. From 1939 until his death, the editor-in-chief of Aufbau was Manfred George, born Manfred Georg Kohn. An undated list of Paris members suggests that Stein and George knew each other from the Paris exile. Like his successor, Hans Steinitz, Manfred George had also been a member of the Association of German Journalists in Exile. In the exhibition, we also presented Stein's collaboration with the well-known publisher Wieland Herzfelde. In exile in Prague, Herzfelde had continued to run the Malik Verlag, one of the most important left-wing literary publishers of the Weimar Republic. In New York, he founded the Aurora Publishing House together with Ernst Bloch, Bertolt Brecht, Alfred Döblin, Leon Feuchtwanger, Heinrich Mann, Berthold Viertel, and others. To make a living, Herzfelde opened the Seven Seas book and stamp shop where Stein probably took this photograph. In the preparation for the founding of the publishing house, Hatzfeldt sent Stein a list of authors whose portraits were to be printed in the first prospectus. 6 of 13 photographs in the 1945 production plan were by Fritz Stein. Others were provided by Lotte Jacobi and Josef Breitenbach. For reasons of health, Stein concentrated entirely on portrait photography after 1950, taking pictures of prominent personalities from the fields of literature, theater, art, music, science, and politics. A selection of 40 portraits was shown in the exhibition under the title Creative Minds, for example, of Thornton Wilder, Aldous Huxley, Marlene Dietrich, François Sagan. Stein also enlarged portrait-like sections of the images, as can be seen in this photo of writer Ingeborg Bachmann, photographed at a reception at the Goethe House in New York. I live more or less as you know me, a lot of small bread and butter jobs and some plum jobs that now and then come to something, Stein wrote in a 1958 letter. By plum jobs, he probably meant his solo and group exhibitions and book projects. On the left, the American-German review with an article on the occasion of Stein's show at the Karl Schurz Memorial Foundation in Philadelphia. On the right, Stein's photo book, Deutsche Porträts, with 100 portraits from 1961, his biggest publication during lifetime. In 1958, Stein started to work with the German press agency DPA and thus came into contact with the German publisher. In addition to portraits of Hannah Arendt and Willy Brandt, for example, from Stein's emigrant archive, the book also contained new pictures, including some photos of collaborators with the Nazi regime, such as Alfred Krupp von Bohlen und Halber, and the actor Gustav Gründgens. To Willy Brandt, Stein explained, apologizing, it seems, that the publisher had probably received the list of those to be photographed from official circles in Bonn. Following the controversial Deutsche Porträts, Stein worked on an anthology on the topics of antisemitism, national socialism, and racism, with the working title, That Was Not Our Germany, German Poets and Thinkers Against the Third Reich. In this book, which could be seen as a kind of corrective to the Deutsche Porträts, not the portraits, but the writings of the emigrant writers was to be in the center. Quote, the coming generations can't learn enough about the past. Stein had refrained from political work in the USA. To me, it seems as if with this project, he intended to find a new form for his political commitment. The project remained unfinished. This brings me to the end of my presentation. Stein has called himself a headhunter who, quote, often photographed his prey unobserved, for example, in cocktail parties. Stein can also be called a collector with a special passion that was ignited in Paris in the Association of German Journalists in Exile, where he, quote, systematically met many immigrants and photographed them. This passion did not let go of him, quote, even today I keep photographing immigrants of this period, especially writers, he wrote in 1963. Stein believed his collection of portraits of German-speaking immigration was, quote, probably the largest photo collection of such authors that a photographer has ever taken himself. It is my opinion that this is his unique photographic achievement and historical legacy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ulrike. We now have a little time for a Q&A, so please post your questions. And I would like to actually start with a question to Ulrike, because we just had a brief conversation before, and I found out that you basically did your research not in the archives and that Peter Stein has organized, but because of COVID, that you had to do your extensive research in other ways. So I would like to know how you did this, how you brought together so much information about Fred Stein.
Yeah, luckily we had already good contact with Peter Stein from before, from the Hannah Arendt exhibition. And Peter was extremely helpful because he provided all scan material he had. So I had, 50, 60 letters, which I researched. That's also why I have so many quotes of Fritz Stein. And since I couldn't travel to the Fritz Stein archive, to the USA, I tried to do research in Germany. And luckily, I could go to the archive of the Berliner Akademie der Künste, which has archives of many people whom Fritz Stein actually had photographed. So I found, for example, photographs and other documents in the archive of Wieland Herzfelde, of course, as I showed in the presentation, in the Willy Bredel archive and Bertolt Brecht archive. And it was interesting, for example, in the Bertolt Brecht photo archives, there were actually prints really from the 1930s, which are probably very rare. Since Fritz Stein had lost his photo collection when they fled France, he was only able to take with him the negatives, but not prints. So I was very happy also that we could lend some original photographs from the 1930s for the show. And of course, I also went to the Deutsches Exilarchiv, German Exile Archive in Frankfurt. In Frankfurt, where there is a big collection of Fritz Stein's photographs, but also documents from the Emergency Rescue Committee. And this is actually where I got my information from. And of course, I had intense email conversations with Peter, and I got the list, and he sent me scans. He made new scans for me of material in the archive or photographs in the archive. And luckily, I was also able to go to Hanover, where there was had been a Fritz Stein exhibition before, so I could have a look at original prints which Inga Schubel had lent for the exhibition. So, although I could not go and see Fritz Stein's work in the archive, I had many other possibilities in Germany.
That is absolutely fabulous. And I just see that the chat is disabled. So please put your questions in the Q&A section until I enable the chat function. And So Linda is asking whether there's any chance that the exhibition will come to the US, and that's a question for Peter, of course.
Yeah, I wish it could. It's all been dismantled and all the pictures were returned. But right now that I'm retired from teaching, I'm retired from being a cinematographer, my full-time job is to promote my father's work. So I thank you for your question. And I am trying to get exhibitions all the time, all over the world. And if anybody can help in that regard, I would be grateful. But let me say that in Germany, we've had more exhibitions than anywhere else. In the United States, it's so hard because museums are not supported as well by the government as they are in Europe. And so it's hard for museums to take a relatively unknown photographer and give them an expensive exhibition, and without, because they need to attract people and get the money from entrance fees. So we've had great success in Germany and moderate success in France, but really the United States is where Fred photographed most often. And so I'm really trying, I try all the time and I write emails, but it's really hard without personal contacts. And it's very hard to get in touch with the photography curators and museum directors.
Yeah.
So we do have exhibitions. We have a wonderful gallery in New York, the Rosenberg and Co. Gallery, which is off of Fifth Avenue. We have exhibitions periodically, but museum exhibitions is really how one would really establish someone as an artist.
Yeah, right. Peter, there's another question for you from Annette. Could you talk about how your father on a personal level coped with the difficulties of emigration, such as losing your livelihood, having to start again in a new country, and so on and so forth?
Well, I find it remarkable that my father had to start again in two countries. And I mean, there are many refugees today that are going through similar or even harder stories. But, you know, to start again, first of all, he started to get some success in France, and there were articles actually written about him and his work in London, and he was having pictures published in the United States. But so my parents were getting somewhat comfortable financially through his work in France, and then it all fell apart when they had to come to the United States, and he made most of his income, but because he was freelance, he never worked for anybody or any organization. But my mother really supported the family, and her story is another amazing story. But she believed in him as an artist. It was not easy for him, and there were no emails at the time, and he tried writing letters and so on. But he was becoming somewhat known. But he died very early, and he died at the age of 58 in 1967. And photography really wasn't recognized as the art form that it is today. So many of his contemporaries who were of the similar quality of ability and work and art, they became famous. They got galleries and so on, and their galleries got the museum shows. But Fred died in 1967, and photography really started taking off in the late 80s.
Do you know, either of you, I think, if Stein was involved with the exiled painters in Paris? An example being the painter Gerd Wolheim, who later ended up in New York City.
I think he photographed Wolheim. I'm pretty sure. Do you remember that, Ulrike?
No.
I don't know the answer to that, but I'm 90% sure that he photographed Wolheim.
Okay. Something to look for and research. Joseph is asking, did Hannah Arendt like the photograph of herself with a cigarette?
Aha. Well, all I know is that she said Fred Stein is her favorite photographer.
Okay.
And she loved his work, and he didn't just take her picture. They spent time together with her husband, Blucher, Blücher.
Heinrich Blücher. Yeah, we had in the exhibition, we had a letter where she confirmed that he is one of the best contemporary portrait photographers. And I wrote an article for the Deutsches Historisches Museum blog about Hannah Arendt and Fritz Stein concerning photography.
Yeah, the DHM, History Museum, that you were involved with the Hannah Arendt exhibition, they had a separate Fred Stein show in the middle of Hannah Arendt, in the middle of the big Hannah Arendt exhibition, which was that was fun to see. Unfortunately, I didn't get to go to see the show in person.
Yeah, I didn't include in my presentation the most famous Hannah Arendt and portrait which Fritz Stein did. And what I really learned from your presentation, what I didn't know before, that they produced postcards in France to earn a living. This was really something new for me.
Yeah.
And it also explains the special quality of some of the street photographs, because sometimes they are really easy to understand and very pictorial. They have a very special pictorial quality, which probably Stein intended to have, just to sell them easily.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Well, I'm sure he printed each one himself. You know, you could, I'm 100% sure you could buy photographic paper cut in postcards with the back printed as a postcard, and the front you could, so he, each postcard he printed himself, and then, you know, it
might be possible to buy Fritz Stein vintage prints on a Paris flea market.
I have a couple of postcards from the day that were actually mailed. So I always check eBay for what people might be selling of Fred Stein.
Yeah, great. We went over time already. Two more questions, and I'm afraid we have to close then. So Ted is asking whether there are German reparations available because Fred had to flee.
Well, my parents got money for the house, along with many of the other family members. Mm-hmm. During reunification, after reunification, and my father actually got a pension from the German government because he had to stop his law studies, and mm-hmm. so that all of a sudden took a lot of pressure off my parents, financial pressure, once mm-hmm. they got that. Must have been in the late 50s or early 60s. They actually gave him, as if he had advanced through the legal system to be a judge. So they gave him a pension as if he was a judge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wonderful. Monica is asking whether Fred Stein have any problems during the McCarthy era. I think that's a question for both of you too, right?
Well, I should answer that because he could not get his citizenship, and he was, my mother got her citizenship, but he could not get his citizenship, and he never knew why, and he enlisted the Jacob Javits, the wonderful senator from New York, and a judge, Irving Sapol, and they found out it was because he was a member of the Photo League. And mm-hmm. he said, well, I left the Photo League because I found that they were very pro-communist. Mm-hmm. And I don't think all the people knew that, but Fred was very anti-communist, he was anti-fascist, mm-hmm. and although he was a socialist, so when he got Angela, which Ulrike mentioned, He got Angela Calamaris, who was a double agent or an agent, not a double agent, but an agent for the FBI, who was working as a secretary in the photo league. He had given her a resignation letter and she testified for him, and then he became a citizen.
Mm-hmm. Good for him. Very, very smart. I want to close. First of all, I want to thank both of you. I learned so much about Fred Stein, and he's definitely someone who we all should explore much more and hope to see much more about. So I wanted to end with two really statements, one by David, who says, "Congrats on a great presentation of the history of what I would call the life of the mind. Thank you." And Carol is saying, "Delightful interaction between the guests. I feel Fred Stein present. Great photos and stories. Many thanks to all." So, and Rebecca is just coming with, "Thank you for another marvelous presentation." So the thank yous are pouring in, and I want to close with that. Thank you. I want to thank you also for presenting Fred Stein. And yeah, thanks a lot, and everybody be well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.